speaker. Our next speaker is Mrs. Leila Miller. You might want to come around here to where the steps are. So what we've seen here in Dr. Baskerville's talk is the injustice of the family court. And he's been looking at it principally from the position of adults in society. Mrs. Miller is going to look at the rights of children. So Dr. Baskerville talked about the rights of parents to have their own households and to have control and responsibility and relationship with their children. Mrs. Miller is going to talk with us about the rights of children to their parents and what happens when that's violated. So Mrs. Miller is a mother of 8 children and a Catholic author and apologist, and she has written a very important book called Primal Loss, The Now Adult Children of Divorce Speak, and it's a compilation of interviews with about 70 adult children of divorce. And I notice online that people are tweeting and writing about this conference. One hashtag that you may want to use during her talk is the one that says hashtag ACOD, Adult Children of Divorce. So I think there are things happening on that line, so if people would like to tweet with that hashtag, that would be a wonderful thing. So help me in welcoming Mrs. Leila Miller.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Morse, and boy, Dr. Baskerville, that was really frightening. I'm here to talk about the effects of divorce on children, and they are long-term. I did not set out to be a spokesman on this issue, and I have no direct I have no direct experience with divorce myself. I am not divorced. My parents are not divorced. My grandparents were not divorced. I have always been against divorce, but I realize now that for most of my life it was mostly lip service. Essentially, I was walking around as someone from an intact family, minding my own business for about 50 years, and then came a small breach of my ignorance. My friend Alicia Hansen, a 40-something wife and mother of 6, would, in the course of our regular conversations, mention a complication, a hardship, or an emotional stressor here or there, that things that were related to the divorce of her parents many years ago when she was just 6 years old. And I was struck by the unfamiliarity of what she was talking about, but it sounded like a heavy burden that she carried on her back. And I said to her, well, you should probably write this down, and you know, people need to know this. And she never did, but I decided to. So I took to my social media platforms and I asked if any adult children of divorce wanted to answer a few questions for me anonymously. I received nearly 100 responses in the first couple of days, and I sent each of them a questionnaire that I had quickly whipped up off the top of my head. I'm not a scholar. There were simple questions about how the divorce of their parents had affected them. And I cannot overstate how crucial it was to make this anonymous for them. I got a lot of variations of this sentiment. Quote, thank you for anonymity. I don't want anyone to know the extent of how damaged I am. And that was from a woman in her late 40s. And from a 35-year-old woman, I am so scared to share the details because despite the incredible odds against this happening, I'm just sure that my mom or dad will read this book and immediately recognize which anonymous character is me. I am in an actual panic. That is the kind of reaction I have when I have even the slightest fear that they will find out how this has hurt me. And she says even her husband of 15 years, they've known each other 21 years, didn't know even until last year that there was real damage from the divorce. The answers I received from the 70 men and women who could answer the questions, because many emotionally could not get to answering those questions at all, were shocking to me. I got what I refer to as an avalanche of pain. The scales dropped from my eyes completely, and it became horrifyingly clear that I had been walking around unencumbered for half a century, while millions of walking wounded were in an isolated and dark pain all around me. I believe that I represent millions of Americans who have no idea. In my book, Primal Loss, The Now Adult Children of Divorce Speak, I actually don't speak a word in the eight main chapters. In this talk, I want these children to speak to you directly as well. And you will see that the loss of their family is primal. When God created man in the garden, there were 3 things that were foundational to human beings: life, male and female, and marriage. And our culture is doing a great job of destroying human life, of destroying male and female, and now, of course, also, we know, destroying marriage. One of the essential elements of marriage, as ordained by God, is permanence. Divorce undoes that order of creation. God intended children to be born to their married mom and dad, and of course this was purposeful and important. A child has a natural and a God-given right to his own married mother and father, who are to raise and nurture and form him up until adulthood, at which point family origins would still remain intact. All the goods that marriage is divinely designed and naturally ordered to give a child, divorce takes away. And let's talk about just a few of those. First, there is a set of things that tend to go together. The ideas of identity, wholeness, security, and stability. As a child of an intact family, I had and have no issues with my identity or the rest of that list. I know who I am. I know where I belong. I know where home is. I know where my family is. My origins are secure and whole. Basically, I have never thought a thing about it. These questions do not occupy any of my brain space, nor do they cause me any emotional turmoil or expense at all. And for a child of divorce, this is not so. The divorce takes his identity, his wholeness, his security, and his stability. As one woman told, one woman whose parents divorced when she was 15 told me, and I've changed the names, for me, she said, the biggest effect of the divorce would probably be my identity. It was who I was. However dysfunctional our family was at times, I was a Jones. I was the daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Michael Jones, and I loved that. I was proud of that. Truly, after the divorce, I was lost and insecure. For a long, long time, I felt like a tree that was uprooted with its roots dangling above ground. I had deep-seated feelings of low self-worth and fell more deeply into a life of sin. And a woman in her mid-50s, whose parents divorced about 45 years ago, said this, because of this compartmentalization after divorce, done mostly subconsciously as a child, I have a very hard time figuring out and accepting who I am. And another woman, 48, whose parents divorced when she was 12, recounts her childhood experience asking, why was there so much pain? No family to go home to. My family was now broken. I had no family. So alone, so broken. What is life like now in adulthood? I just pretend everything is good for the sake of my children. It never goes away, though. Ever make a family tree project in school? Oh, look, broken. And from another child of divorce, quote, growing up, I used to watch my friends act in ways that were foreign to me. They were oddly self-assured and free of worry. I couldn't make sense of the world or myself in it. And another, I felt like I had to be one person when I was with my dad and another when I was with my mom. And another whose parents divorced and remarried several times. I had two places to live, but no home. I recently realized that I was forced to abandon and then reconstitute my idea of family 7 times by the time I was 23. I think this is way too much to ask of somebody. And another, Riley said of her parents' multiple divorces and remarriages, a flowchart would be helpful. And another, and there's repetition here because I want you to see these are unrelated people. Another, a parent might be able to totally start over with a new spouse, experiencing freedom from the first marriage, and only minimal contact with the first spouse. For the child, however, their worlds will forever be fundamentally split. Forever. There is no starting over with a clean slate. Things are now complicated and fractured. Divorce starts a family onto 2 different paths that, as the years unfold, grow further and further apart. It is not a one-time event, but rather an ever-changing and ever-widening gap that only the children are really tasked with straddling and reconciling, season after season, change after change. And yet another, speaking to the adults who choose divorce. Divorce hurts. It hurts. It hurts. But worse is your desire to move on and pretend that my first family never existed and that half of me no longer exists. You take photos of the other half of my family tree down and you imagine I don't notice or care. I do notice and I do care. That's half of me. That family really did exist and it is really important to me. Just because you want to move on doesn't give you the right to erase half my family. First families matter. And I want to mention here a book that I know, I've seen it back there. It's sold by the Ruth Institute called Marriage and Equality by Jennifer Johnson. And it's just a tiny little book that has a very profound impact, especially due to the simple images and charts that she uses in that book to show how the children of divorce are not on equal footing in life and society with the children of intact families. There is no equality there. She figured out early that while she had two half-time dads, her biological dad and her stepdad, her half-sister, who came later, just had one dad, a full-time dad, and her half-sister lived with her own married parents, which were Jennifer's mom and stepdad. What Jennifer had, which was a broken family and a constant transfer from house to house, and what her half-sister had, which was one home with a full-time mom and dad, were two very different lives. She said, in each home, I was required to pretend that my other parent and that parent's family did not exist. So while in my mother's home, I had to pretend that my father and his family did not exist, and while in my father's home, I had to pretend that my mother and her family did not exist. With everyone else in the homes, photos of the other people's whole family were on the wall, but not of my whole family. So honestly, you know, take a look at that book. It's incredible. Here's another woman. This is a little lengthy, but it's a description that has been seared into my brain because of all those happy co-parenting narratives that you see on the internet all the time. This woman says, "We increasingly hear happy parents and step-parents proclaiming, we all go together to the kids' soccer games, and co-parenting is awesome, via the photos and articles that go viral on the internet. A celebration of blended families that lulls fence sitters into thinking that a divorce won't be so bad for the kids." She says, "But I was that kid, and I had great anxiety as a child athlete in a divorced family with step-parents. For example, I once had a step-parent ask me why I would hug my mom first after a game before hugging anyone else. So the anxious self-questioning begins. Who should I hug first? Will the other parents be offended? Who should I go sit with? Should I ride home with this set of parents, or would that upset the other parents? Oh no, both sets want to take me out for ice cream afterwards. Who do I go with? Which set will be less offended if I don't choose them? Who should I ask for money for a snack? I remember the time I got hurt in a game and only one parent was allowed in the x-ray room with me, but all the parents were there. Who do I choose? I chose my mom, and my stepmom rolled her eyes because I didn't choose my dad. All that I have just described is anxiety surrounding only a sporting event in the life of a child of divorce," she said. "It does not even touch the surface of the real life anxieties that children face who come from divorced families, even into adulthood. Despite the smiling pictures applauded online, there's not so much of awesome as there is of injustice toward the child." And frankly, just reading about these anxieties and descriptions gives me a little bit of distress. So I don't know how a child lives this. One man told me, "One thing I absolutely hated was packing up on Fridays and schlepping over to my father's house, which had formerly been our house. It was worse after he remarried and moved her in along with all her kids from a prior marriage. The mental preparations for weekends at dad's were stressful. The visits themselves were stressful." Beth Sree sums it up in a recent article. She only recently came out as a child of divorce with her pain. That's Edward Sree's wife, if you know him. She said, "Essentially, there were two Beths. I had two lives, two personas, split straight down the middle. The task of making sense of these two competing worlds fell squarely on my duffel-bearing shoulders. Deep within me, I craved wholeness, though I didn't realize this at the time. Who am I deep down? How do I make sense of these two opposing realities?" And I don't have time to go into the effects today of a child seeing one's mom or dad in a romantic or sexual relationship with a person who is not his other living parent. That is its own heartbreak and calamity. But this woman's comment is representative of the sentiment that with new romance and or remarriage, the child is the lesser consideration and displaced. She says, "The dating parent doesn't want the significant other to feel uncomfortable, so the child is temporarily or permanently abandoned. The happiness of the current romantic couple always trumps the happiness of the child, always." Another contributor describes the long-term nature of the family fracture. quote, it doesn't just affect the children, but their children and their children's children. A divorce has tentacles that are far-reaching. Each severing and reattachment brings with it a whole extended family, which might also be broken, and statistically is. Second marriages don't last as long as first. And the connections become more and more tenuous. These are houses built on sand. And folks who divorce when their children are grown are not necessarily sparing their children the same kind of loss of identity and security. For one lady whose parents divorced when she was 32 years old, quote, my parents' divorce was devastating. I felt like my foundation and sense of safety was destroyed. It was made worse by the fact that I felt powerless to protect my own children from the fallout. My husband already came from a broken home, and our last example of normalcy and stability was blown to bits. And from a 50-year-old man who was 33 when his mom divorced his dad, quote, I am shocked at how affected I am. To sum up the loss of identity, wholeness, stability, and security that comes with divorce, let's hear from one more man and one more woman. This man in his 30s told me, what hits me the hardest is that there is no going home anymore. When parents in intact families move to a new house after the children grow up, there is still that place to go to where the two parents act as they always have. Mom cooks dinner, the same Christmas decorations go up, albeit in different places. Dad carves the ham, and so on. Familiar smells with familiar activities. For the children of divorce, all those reminders of the home they grew up in are gone. Home isn't really a place after all, but an experience. The child knows that everything is now different. Who gets my birthday? Both, I guess. It's not two birthdays, just two separate halves that don't add up to a whole. And a woman also in her 30s. Imagine the family as an airplane in flight. You can do many things on a plane, including argue, and still get to your destination safe and intact. But divorce is a parent opening the emergency exit mid-flight, depressurizing the entire cabin, and jumping out while pulling the ripcord on a parachute for only themselves, all the while yelling that you'll be fine. A child can't make sense of why the parent did this. They are merely left with a crisis on a broken plane without a way to navigate well or land safely and intact. And speaking of safety, while we have talked about the pervasive emotional damage done, we don't have time to talk about the financial and physical risks of divorce for children, which are very real and which social science continually bears out. An intact family provides a huge measure of physical and financial safety for a child that divorce takes away. Again, that's a whole other 40-minute talk. But what else does marriage give to a child that divorce takes away? The ability to deal with conflict and to have long-lasting relationships. When I went into marriage, my husband Dean is back there, it was not an anxiety-ridden experience. It never crossed my mind that it would ever be anything other than permanent, no matter what bad would come in the future. Marriage was for life, period, and that was a peaceful understanding. But that's not how the children of divorce view it. Even the ones who will never divorce because they're just committed to not doing that to their children. The marriage comes with fear and baggage that affect them and their relationship with their spouse. Remember, they have learned that conflict leads to permanent separation. And that when someone becomes unlovable, then he or she is cast aside. So there's this often debilitating angst that comes when it comes to their own relationships and marriage. So this woman is representative of so many. And by the way, all these people that I think I'm about to quote, they're still in their marriages, but there are plenty that I quote in the book and elsewhere that didn't make it, and they were either divorced against their will or they just sabotaged their own relationship. So this woman says, for the first few years of my marriage, I was very on guard and prepared for my husband to leave. In fact, I expected it. I would stash away money, hiding it in a drawer or in my purse. I occasionally looked at the cost of one-bedroom apartments. It wasn't that I wanted him to leave, but in my mind, it wasn't even a question of if it would happen, but when it would happen. I fell further into a state of despair once we had our first child. I would always think about how I would take care of my child on my own, how custody would work, etc. It took many years for me to get past those feelings, and the thought of my husband leaving now never crosses my mind. However, I still remember when it consumed my every thought. And the theme of self-sabotage is common. One woman told me, We fear abandonment, and we often sabotage our relationships for fear of getting too close to someone and getting hurt all over again. I didn't know how to receive and accept real love. In the end, I would ultimately find a way to escape or sabotage the relationship to avoid the pain. It was a no-win situation for me. And I can't remember if this is the same lady who broke off 5 engagements to what she described as very good men. She finally did get married and is happily married now. Another woman. When my mother moved away when I was age 10, my fears of abandonment were strongly confirmed. Once I was married, whenever my husband and I would hit a rough patch, I would want to bail. And it's a miracle of the grace and mercy of God that we are still married now. And another, the constant lack of security I always feel carries over into my own marriage. Like if my father could betray my mother, me, and my sister, why is my own husband above doing that? The bottom line is that my parents' divorce has brought insecurity into my own marriage. How could my husband love me enough never to betray our vows? Really, how is that even possible? I hate feeling that way. Another woman, married 19 years. The beginning of our marriage was difficult. As soon as I got married, I was sure my husband would cheat. I thought that unless I could keep him perfectly happy, he would leave me. It seems bizarre to me today because he is such a good man, but it was really an honest fear. This led to so many fights, and I became so insecure and unhappy. And another, I have it in the back of my mind that things could all go wrong at any moment, and then I'd be on my own as a single mother. I feel like I have to be as independent as I possibly can be, just in case. It has made it more difficult for me to trust and even think long term. And yet another, I struggle with trusting my husband. I am always waiting for the other shoe to drop, which I am sure must be related to the feeling of abandonment by my family of origin. And from a man still unmarried in his late 30s, marriage seems impossible. I desire it, but I fear it. My desire to avoid hurting my future children is exceptionally strong. I do not want them to know the pain I have known. And another man who is married for many years now, I believe that since the beginning of my marriage, I have been testing its permanency. I have been playing, I'll leave you before you leave me, or I'll keep you at a distance so you can't hurt me, for most of my life. And from a married woman in her 50s, if a child is constantly aware that half of him is unacceptable to one parent and that parent's family, how can he ever find himself acceptable or trust a partner who claims that all of him is acceptable? By the way, she says, in just reading over that last sentence, it seems so matter-of-fact. It's impossible to convey how truly debilitating and soul-wrenching that ingrained unacceptability becomes. And another, I don't think people understand how guarded someone can become, especially someone who has been taught that love is conditional. And another, I started getting snippy with my husband, and he managed to coax out of me that I was distancing myself from him on purpose, because it would make it easier for me when he left me. He was shocked. Why would I think he'd leave me? I reminded him of all the fathers that have come and gone, and he's just the next in line. I still think things like, that's it, this is going to be the time I spend too much on groceries, and he's going to blow up and leave. And another woman says this despite her strong and happy marriage. I fear more than anything else abandonment. It's an irrational fear. My husband is a saint. I do still fear after 32 years of marriage that he will leave. I sometimes despair to the point of suicidal thoughts, feeling I am unworthy of love. I ask him constantly if he is mad or if he still loves me. I do have those dark times, and these are agonizing moments. What on earth must it be like to internally always carry that type of fear and anxiety and even agony? I personally cannot even imagine it. And I have not even gotten into the distress and disruption divorce causes in a child's relationship with God the Father. When a religious family goes through a divorce, the children's faith is at grave risk and very often does not survive. So we must think, what happens to a society when the foundations of millions upon millions of its citizens are shattered in this way? What happens to the stability of marriage and of society when all of these walking wounded have no tools or examples for how to navigate, are full of fear and anxiety and lack of trust, etc.? So all of us are affected by divorce. We see a culture that is in free fall, and we are missing a huge piece of what is wrong because the silence on this issue is deafening. But why the silence? Why, as my bishop, Bishop Thomas Olmsted, has said, why is some suffering not allowed to be called suffering? It's because of what some of us call the narrative. The narrative that divorce is a necessary and even a very good thing, and that the kids will be fine, is drilled into the culture and into the kids, and it's the air we breathe. We do not tolerate those who contradict that narrative. Dr. Jennifer Robach Morris wrote the powerful foreword to Primal Loss. She's very generous in doing so, a self-published book. And she stressed that no-fault divorce and divorce affirmation are essential to the success of the sexual revolution. She wrote, "To keep the divorce fantasy world alive, anyone who does not follow the socially approved divorce script must be silenced. This is bad enough for abandoned spouses, but for children of divorce, it is a living nightmare. The kids are socially invisible. If they have a problem, we take them to therapy. We put them on medication. We never admit that it might be the adults who were the problem here and that they should have done things differently. Because the children are not speaking out about the pain of divorce, protesting against it, we think that all is well. But listen to Catholic author Leila Lawler, herself a child of divorce. She's in her 50s now, and her parents divorced decades ago. She said, I have always said that you simply can't ask a child what he thinks about his parents' divorce. There is too much at stake. For the child to admit that he has received a blow he may not recover from is too frightening. And in almost every case, the child feels he has to protect his parents, who are obviously no longer in control of their own lives. If only for his own preservation, for the child has no autonomy. Without his parents, he will be exposed to nameless danger. No, you must wait until the child has grown, and then you may be able to find out what happened to his inner life when his world fell apart. And from Catholic blogger Melody Lyons on why she could not speak of her pain, she said, if divorce was good, better, and best, and if my parents were wholly justified and excellent decision makers, then I must have been a worthless person for all the sadness, grief, and anger I carried. While my own parents were lifted up and extolled for their courage by the long list of counselors, friends, and priests that I sought out for help with my runaway grief, I was crushed under the knowledge that my grief, which I was helpless to, was standing in the way of their happiness. And so, like millions of other children, she confirmed the narrative. She said, I repeated the lies told to me by others for years because I thought my real feelings were wrong. I stuck to the party line. Yeah, my folks split. It's for the best. I'm glad they're happier. Back to the words of Dr. Robach Morris. Even inside the family, the children are not permitted to voice their real feelings. Love inside the family feels fragile. The kids have absorbed the message that people sometimes leave each other or get kicked out. Even if children could verbalize their feelings, which they can't, they are afraid to risk losing their parents' love. They don't want to upset mom or dad. They learn to silence themselves. One woman recounted to me that from the age of 6 onward, she learned to lie in order to get attention and to make her parents happy. Another said, as a kid, I was always sad and always trying to keep everyone else happy. You're going to see a theme here. Another went to his father's second wedding and said he was, quote, forced to put on a happy face. And yet another told me, as a child, I had to go along with the divorce. As painful as it was wrong of me to dislike it. I was supposed to be happy that my parents weren't going to be fighting anymore, even though I don't really remember them fighting that much. And another, kids are people pleasers, whether it's for mom or dad, their teacher, or another person in authority in their lives. They may look happy or sound happy if that's what you want from them, but that doesn't always mean that way down deep they are happy. No one knew when I was struggling, when I was depressed, when I was cutting or starving myself or having sex to fill the void in my heart that was created by the divorce. When people asked, I said I was fine. And another, children know that their feelings are trumped by their parents' feelings. If a parent expresses feelings that are not in line with what the child is feeling, the child's feelings are negated and moved inward. Those feelings are hidden. Kids are not happy. They are siding with the parent out of fear because kids instinctually fear neglect. The kids might even repeat kids are happy when their parents are happy so as not to offend the parents. After all, if they left each other, what's stopping the parents from leaving the child? And another, I was the kind of kid who never wanted anyone to feel bad or suffer, so I said, it's fine, I understand. I didn't even know my pain was buried. And children are good at adapting and pushing things inside and hiding them there, but there's a difference between adapting and recovering. And another, I put on a happy face, well, maybe a grimace, for so long, and I didn't address my own pain because I don't want my parents to be upset by it. And when my father got remarried, I remember thinking, well, at least he's happy. That's what it's all about. I didn't realize then that life isn't about making yourself happy. And another, I was taught and it was repeatedly emphasized that the divorce was a good thing. Without it, Mom would never have been whole or happy. And we want to keep our parents happy so they don't leave us too, like they left each other. And yet another, too often the children feel silenced and that they have no voice. They're too scared to say anything because they've already seen what happens when someone stops loving another person. They push them away and out of their lives. I wonder if these children fear that the same thing will happen to them. And another, upon seeing her parents start dating, I acted like I didn't care, but only because it hurt so much. To protect myself, I blocked it out and I pretended it didn't matter. And one child said that as a child, I lived and pretended as if everything is okay, but everything was wrong. Just this week, I received this as part of an email from a 30-something woman. She said, the fear of admitting our pain to our parents is so real. So just keep that in mind when you hear all the happy divorced kids say, this is the, oh, it's great. I have no problem with my parents' divorce, all fine. And some, this is very fascinating, some kids stuff their pain and feelings down so far and buy the narrative so completely that they're not even aware of what's happening. Here's a testimony from a woman I know that she read parts of the entries to my book before it was actually published, and she said this, and I managed to get it into the book, actually. She said, I'm 100% Catholic, and I know that divorce is wrong, but after reading what other children of divorce had to say, I'm realizing that from the age of 5 on, I've been essentially brainwashed into believing that my parents' divorce was the right decision. In fact, even as I type this, I can still barely bring myself to question it. I have said the words to my parents, I'm glad you got divorced, and I didn't think twice about it. It's only now that I'm starting to think twice. Isn't that crazy? I've never imagined that their divorce wasn't absolutely necessary and that we weren't all the better off for it, even though ours wasn't a situation of finding safety from abuse. My parents so convinced me that it was the right choice, the only choice, that I never questioned it. Never have I ventured to think that my own parents should have remained married. People in your book are telling their parents to fight harder, and that never ever crossed my mind. It's as if these people think their parents weren't supposed to get divorced, and then I'm like, wait a minute, they weren't supposed to. I think some scales have just fallen from my eyes, and I need to rethink this whole thing. Okay, so now you've heard a lot of pain, and that's just a drop in the ocean. So what can we do to ease the pain that we have put upon these countless children in this society? We can make them feel like they're not crazy. That's number one. We can speak the truth, and by doing so, we can set them free from a lot of their burdens and anguish. Consider these recent emails that I have received, and they come to me nonstop. Quote, thank you for giving a voice to the children and adults that up until now have really felt voiceless. You cannot know how relieved I feel, knowing that I'm really not too sensitive or overly emotional to still be struggling in some ways from my parents' divorce in 1984. I found myself thinking, wow, other people feel like I do throughout the whole book. And here's a 67-year-old woman. 50 years have gone by since her parents' divorce, and she recently saw me interviewed on EWTN. She said, I was glued to the TV and immediately thought that finally I had discovered that there are others feeling and expressing the exact same sentiments and feelings as me. Finally, I'm not alone in all this. Can you imagine? Millions of children of divorce walking around the same feelings. 50 years, she never knew anyone else had that same feeling. This is how crazy this is. And from a 30-year-old woman who read the testimonies in Primal Loss, she said, going through this book has been like reading my own soul. I finally feel heard and understood. It's like someone finally asked me how my parents' divorces have truly affected me and actually wanted to hear and understand the answer. I cannot tell you strongly enough what an incredible gift that is. She told me that she finally, again, this is all finally, somebody's saying something. She finally understands that the anxiety she carries as she considers marriage, you know, that she's not crazy, and that was a great gift to her. So I'm gonna end by quoting Melody Lyons again, who gives us excellent advice on how we can help the children of divorce feel not crazy. She says this. She said, "I would have given a lot to hear these words growing up." This is what we should have said to her. "What happened between your mom and dad was bad. Families are designed to love each other forever, and that didn't happen in yours. Your family was dismantled without your consent. And now you are left with an anger and sorrow that are justified. Justified. Everything you are feeling is normal, and you will grow through it, and you will thrive. God will bring joy out of suffering, and I will walk with you." And she said this, "That wouldn't have fixed everything, but it would have taken a burden off of my soul and freed my heart and mind to begin healing much earlier. But the counselors, teachers, priests, and professionals in my K-12 years didn't say it, not in Catholic grade schools, not in the first grade when I made an appointment with my pastor, not family friends, not the high school professionals, not even the junior high and teen divorce support programs I joined in school, desperately seeking a balm for my ongoing guilt and grief. Those groups focused instead on affirming my right to feel in general, but then attempted to change those feelings as if they were disordered and out of place. They were not. I was normal, but I didn't know. Now we all know. So please, let us tell the truth. Let us work to protect marriage in our own spheres of influence, especially, and let us always take the side of the children of divorce. So much has been taken from them, so let's at least give them back their voice. Thank you."
Thank you. Thank you very much. Before we let... how about it, huh? Thanks very much. Thanks so much. All right, before we go to our break, this is Leila's book, Primal Loss, and there are people in this audience who contributed to it. And this is the other book that she mentioned, Marriage and Equality, by my former colleague Jennifer Johnson, which goes through in so much detail and very simple way why it's unjust to children. So I would like to close this session by saying just one thing for the camera, for the record. I don't care how often divorce takes place. I don't care what the government says about it. I don't care what the Pope in Rome says about it. This is unjust to children. If there is no threat to life or limb, a divorce is unjust to children. And I will never say it's okay. I will never say it's okay. Thank you very much.